show no dignity he wore. You take the nails from his hands. Would you take the place of this man? Would you take the nails from his hands? To tell the weight of the community, the father would say, this is a father. Show the depth of this room, go with every scene, I seem new that this was why he came. Would you take the place of this man? Would you take the nails from his hands? Would you take the place of this man? Would you take the nails from his hands? And we just don't know blood and water flow, and then all he shows how much he cares. And the van was torn, so we can have this open door, and all his things finally been complete. Would you take the place of this man? Would you take the nails from his hands? Would you take the place of this man? Would you take the nails from his hands? From his hands? From his hands?
Amen. Thank you, Lane. Praise the Lord. Welcome to Southside Baptist Church. A great way to start the day off this month, as James will mention to you, that every Sunday we're going to be looking forward towards the cross and also towards the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have special music lined up at each of the services, so be in prayer for those that are going to be sharing over the next few weeks. If you're a guest with us here at Southside Baptist Church, there's a little card in front of you and a seat in front of you. We just ask that you would take that card and fill that card out. And just a little bit of information there, that way to give us a record of your visit here with us at Southside. And also, if there's anything that we could be praying with you about, you can jot that down as well. And after the service, you can set that on the seat where you are seated, and we'll pick those up on the way out. Also, I want to let you know that for the next 2 months, during Christmas time, we promote the Lottie Moon Christmas offering, and in the spring, in March and April, we promote what's called the Annie Armstrong Home Mission Offering. And that mission offering is taken to support our missionaries, over 3,000 missionaries here in North America. So there are some inserts in your bulletin. If you were able to get a bulletin, we ran out of some of those they sent to us. But you can pick that up. This week is what we call the Week of Prayer. And there's a missionary each day that you can be praying for. And then also, Just a couple things I'll call your attention to. Our Easter offering goal this year is $2,500. March 23rd is our church-wide Easter egg hunt. If you have some information or need some information on that, you can see Miss Myra Bishop on that. This coming Thursday, the women's group, craft and fellowship will meet at 10 o'clock this morning on Thursday morning, March 7th. They're going to be stuffing Easter eggs with candy, and then hopefully go out for lunch afterwards. You've got to have lunch food involved in something like that, no matter what you do. So praise the Lord for that. Taylor and Kaylee Pike are in Florida this weekend for a Fellowship of Christian Athletes conference. They'll be back later this evening, so be in prayer for them as well. Also want to let you know today we're going to begin taking our offering up in a public way, and that's going to be part of our worship service from this point forward. And I know many of you still came in and placed your offering in the box in the back. You're still able to do that. And if we could have our ushers come forward at this time, we will receive that offering. And hold on a second. Thank you. Let me pray first. You give us the Lord would lead you for that. And as we are taking up the offering, then there will be a video for Operation Christmas Child that's going to be shown. And then after the video, Leanne and Susie have some information they want to share with you. So let's pray together. Father, we love you. We praise you. We thank you, Lord God, for how you bless us. We thank you, Lord, that we have an opportunity to give back to your kingdom work. Lord, as we pass the plates and take up our tithes and your offerings, Lord, we just pray, Lord, as you would take this and you would just press it down and shake it together and cause it to abound even more, not for our glory, but for your glory, Lord God, that we can continue to do ministry in and through our local church and our community. Lord, we pray, Lord, you bless those that give. We pray, Lord, that you would just bless Southside, but Lord, most of all, that we'd be obedient to your will. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
It doesn't get any more remote than this. We are in the middle of nowhere in Panama, stopping at nothing, even flooded streets that have led us to the back of this pickup truck. But we're still bringing the shoeboxes to kids. Operation Christmas Child, off-road.
On this trip, it's been amazing. We've traveled to some of the most remote parts of the country. And I feel like God's giving me a glimpse of his heart for me and for all of his creations. Just the further and further we went, I'm just thinking, this is incredible. The great lengths that Operation Christmas Child is going to find these children, it just overwhelmed me, that those words, great lengths, because I thought, here, Operation Christmas Child is going to great lengths to reach these children, to find these children, and show them love through these shoeboxes. And to me, I felt like I was saying, that's just a glimpse of the great lengths that I go to search out each and every heart, each and every soul, and let them know that they are loved.
This is for you.
Operation Christmas Child has a real desire to go beyond the box. These shoeboxes are really the segue. They're opening the door for us to teach these children about Jesus.
My wife and I are here with some graduates from The Greatest Journey, which is a 12-week discipleship program.
Each one of these kids at one point received a shoebox, but after that seed was planted, they've each had the chance to go deeper. Operation Christmas Child has done everything within their power to help that seed grow and flourish. And these children are now going back to the other kids and to their parents and to their family. And they know now that God has a plan for them and he loves them. And it's just incredible to see that it all started from a shoebox. The Bible calls us to care for the widows and the orphans, for the forgotten children around the world. And Operation Christmas Child is doing that. At times it would seem like an overwhelming task with so many children in so many parts of the world who have so little. And yet Operation Christmas Child is choosing to go about it like this, one at a time. Every shoebox placed into the hands of a child. And one by one by one, a child is being impacted and being taught about the love of God. There's a song on my record that I sing every night, and it's called One Less, and it has the same heartbeat. It says every single time somebody reaches into the darkness, makes a choice to help the helpless, they let mercy save a life. And that's one less broken heart, Get involved and discover the power of a simple gift this Christmas with Operation Christmas Child.
Susie and I were talking that there's so many of you that are new to our fellowship, and so this video was really great to tell you that it's so much more than giving a kid a box of toys and necessary things, that every box is telling the child about Jesus and opening churches and planting churches. And Larissa Woody and her family, Jordan, got a chance about a year and a half ago and go to Brazil, and they actually got to see an outreach event. And they had, Coral Hill had done these boxes for years, but she said, "Lynn, I had no idea. I had no idea what it really did for the churches that were there." She said the resources that they had, they would have never, ever gotten. So it's so much more than the box. Like he said, the box is the segue. The box lets you in. And so just to show you guys, every child goes home with one of these. It's called the greatest gift. And
they
it's,
get this with their box.
Yeah.
In their own language, though.
Yeah, over 100 languages this is printed in now.
And Braille.
And audio, if they don't have a written language. Yeah. And then as they go through the greatest journey, they're all invited to come back, and it's 12 lessons. And some of our kids have even done this. We did this a few years ago with our kids. And then they have a graduation ceremony, and they're all given a New Testament. And they said most of the time that's the first Bible that's ever been in that home.
And Samaritan's Purse trains them, their local people, so it's done by their local pastors and people in their communities and stuff. So it's not like us going in there to a complete stranger and them trying to listen to somebody from the Western world. It's somebody from their local area that's doing this.
So just to give you a glimpse, it's so much more than just handing a child a box. That's the New Testament.
Yeah, and then they're given the New Testament in their own language when they graduate. So this month we're going to collect some more stuffed animals. I don't know if the slide was up there because I was out of the room. Right. But we're going to collect stuffed animals and cinch bags. We've got quite a few stuffed animals, but we still need quite a few more to get to our 700 goal. So anything you can buy, it'd be great. Just bring it, put it in the box. We'll get them all counted and figure out what else we need. And cinch bags. And for those who don't like to shop, you're welcome to hand somebody some cash or drop a check in the box. We appreciate any and all things, and we promise we'll be good stewards of that money. And we just thank you all for everything you do. It's such a wonderful mission, and we so appreciate the congregation being so involved in that. It's something that we can all do, and we can all be missionaries from right here at home.
Thank you.
All right. Scott, come on up here. Scott, come on up here. We get to baptize another young man today. Just go ahead and just stand right up here right now. I'll get a couple guys to help up here in just a second. And I always try and have the dad, come on up here. Come up and baptize. I think it's very important for them to be involved in this process, and the Lord laid on our hearts some time back, and some of the men here have baptized their kids and just want to do that. So, Skylar, just before we baptize you, Scott, anything you want to share? You're good. All right. All right. Fantastic. Yeah, I'll hand that back off to you then. All right. Come right on in. It's going to be a little warm probably. Just have a seat right there. Scott, come on over here on this side right here. Skylar, I want to ask you a couple questions, okay? All right, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Lord and he came and died on the cross for your sin?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and was there a time in your life that you invited Christ into your heart to be your personal Savior and Lord?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and do you believe that Jesus lives in your life today?
Yes, sir.
All right, you're willing to go forward with baptism? All right, this baptism doesn't save you, but it lets the church know that you're willing to live your life for the Lord. Amen? Amen. I know we've got some folks that are family here today, so if you're part of Skylar's family, why don't you stand, let us recognize you if you're some family and friends that's here, so praise the Lord for that. Thank you for that. I want you to help me with the Pull it back, all right? Skyler, by your profession of faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and obedience to his command, I baptize you now, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And amen. I'm going to grab your nose there. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Go ahead and turn this on. These guys will help you get out.
Children are dismissed to children's church at this time. Everyone else stand. Let's sing together this morning. I stand amazed in the presence.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene.
This next song is a beautiful song. We've sung it before. It says, "We will remember."
We will remember. We will remember. We will remember the words of your hand. We will stop and give you praise, for great is thy faithfulness. We will remember, we will remember, we will remember.
That's on me. Thank you. All right. Praise the Lord. A couple of things I wanted to, I forgot. Sue Bishop, where are you? Sue Bishop. All right. Sue's been out of church for several months, so she was back with us last week, so it's good to see her back with us, so praise the Lord for that. Mr. Sherfy there had been out for about 3 weeks. He had a heart attack, so he's back with us today, so praise the Lord for that. And I heard rumor that Francis Cash was in the building today after having knee replacement surgery. So it's good to see. Randall, it's good to see you too. But Francis, you know, is the one that I want to call attention to. All right. Well, if you have your Bibles this morning, I want to invite you to open your Bibles to the book of Matthew chapter 20. Matthew chapter 20, if you find your way there. We are taking a break from 1st and 2nd Peter. And for this month leading up to Christmas, we're going to be covering some topics. Did I say Christmas again? You know, last Christmas, I guess Christmas was so good, I guess I'm looking for that to be again. So I need to put a post-it note there. Easter. All right, Resurrection Sunday, Easter. All right, praise the Lord for that. Matthew chapter 20, the message this morning is entitled, It's About the Cross. It's about the cross. We're going to begin our journey to Calvary and beyond today. Matthew chapter 20, beginning in verse 17 through verse 19. Did you find that in Matthew chapter 20? Reading from the New American Standard Translation, the scripture said, And Jesus was about to go up to Jerusalem. He took the 12 disciples aside by themselves, and on the way he said to them, Behold, we're going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death. And he will hand him over to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify him. And on the third day, he will be raised up. Let's go to the Lord in prayer again. Father, thank you again for today. Thank you for the opportunity to be in your house. Now, God, we pray that as we, in the next few weeks, take our journey towards the cross, would you remind us of why you went? Would you remind us of our position? Would you remind us of our failure to do anything to bring salvation to us? But would you remind us also that it was through the cross that you would go and you would shed your blood and you would pay the price for our salvation? The song said it's the precious blood of Jesus. And help us always have that in the forefront of our mind, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. As I mentioned, we're going to spend the next 5 weeks as we talk about the cross leading up to some of those events, but also then again on Easter Sunday morning, two opportunities for you. One will be the sunrise service on Easter, and then the other one will be our worship service on Easter. The sunrise service has always been a blessed time to come, and we have an opportunity to have the parking lot here now, and if the weather is not the way we would like for it to be, we've got a canopy that we can be under as well, but the Lord will bless regardless of that. But we're also going to celebrate the resurrection on that Sunday morning as well as our church family together. And of course, there's plenty of folks that are considered C&E Christians, Christmas and Easter Christians. We'll have all churches will have plenty of people that will show up on one of those Sundays as well. So we want to make sure we make room for them. Well, today's message is an introductory message. It's not elementary. It's an introductory message into the journey that we're going to take. But it's also something that we're going to get into the depth of this passage of Scripture, the depth of the text. I hope you have a copy of God's Word. And if you don't have a copy of God's Word, there may be one in front of you in the seat in front of you. But if you have a Bible app, if you want to use that, that's fine too. But there's some verses I want to call your attention to this morning. So this passage being introductory, is an opportunity for us to talk about all that Jesus prepared his disciples for that was about to happen in his life. Now let's just jump right in today. There's four things I want to call your attention to from this passage of Scripture. First of all, I want you to notice the pathway to the cross. The pathway to the cross. It's here in verse number 17. Again, it says, as Jesus was about to go up to Jerusalem. Now, this pathway is recorded for us as far as what Jesus was teaching his disciples in several other places in Scripture. If you have your Bibles open, just real quick, go backward a couple pages and go to Matthew chapter 16, and we'll know this conversation when you turn to it, but if you pick it up in Matthew 16 and verse 13 and following, here's what the Word of God says. When Jesus came to the district of Caesarea Philippi, he was asking his disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? And they said, some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, but still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And he said to them, but who do you say that I am? And Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, because flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. For I say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades or hell will not overpower it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall have been loosed in heaven. And then verse 20, he warned his disciples that they should tell no one that he was the Christ. But look at verse 21 of chapter 16. It says, from that time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and raised up on the third day. Those are almost the identical words that we just read in Matthew chapter 20. But what I want to call your attention to as we look at this pathway to the cross is what Jesus says, or what the writer records here in Matthew chapter 20, verse 17. It says, as Jesus was about to go up to Jerusalem. Now, this would be the third time that Jesus predicts his death on the cross to his disciples. And one of the things that we have to understand here is that it was mandatory for men to bring their families to Jerusalem on a number of occasions during the year, especially when it was a feast or festival. So Jesus would have been in Jerusalem multiple times in his life growing up. But here in this situation, this would be the most important time that Christ would go to Jerusalem. It would be his last time going to Jerusalem because he would go to the cross to die for the sin of all mankind. But I want you to notice what it says in verse 17. It said, as he was about to go up to Jerusalem. Now, from what we understand, and there's differences on the elevation or above or below sea level, but the scripture tells us a little bit later in chapter 20 and verse 29 that they had been leaving Jericho. Jericho is about 500, some would say 500 to 1,000 feet below sea level. Jerusalem would be about 2,500, some say 5,000 feet above sea level. And it would only be about a 15 or 18 mile trek to do that. But from Jericho to Jerusalem, when the scripture says they were going up to Jerusalem, that is a literal translation. They were taking a journey from a lower part in Jericho to a higher part up into Jerusalem. Jesus knows what is coming as he takes this path to Jerusalem. He's getting ready, as one commentator said, he's getting ready to walk right into the fire. He presents himself to his disciples over and over again as the suffering servant, but his disciples didn't understand that he was the suffering servant. The disciples wanted him, and they were looking for an earthly king. As a matter of fact, the Bible records these words in Acts chapter 1. You can jot this reference down in Acts chapter 1 and verse 4 and following. It says, gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, which he said, you've heard from me that John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they were asking him, listen to their question, Lord, is it at this time that you're going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Even though Jesus spent three and a half years with the disciples, even it got to the last point as far as the last week of the life of Jesus, and Jesus is saying, I am the suffering servant. I'm the one that the Old Testament talks about and prophesied about. His disciples still didn't understand that he was the suffering servant because they wanted an earthly king. They just kept thinking that Jesus was going to establish his kingdom here on earth. I'm going to quote a verse of scripture for you. We're going to read it in just a moment. But it's recorded in Luke chapter 18 and verse 31, and listen to what the word says. He took his 12 aside, and he said to them, behold, we're going up to Jerusalem, and listen to what this verse says. All things which are written through the prophets about the Son of Man will be accomplished. All things, not some things, all things. Everything that had been prophesied about Christ was going to come to pass. Everything that Jesus had been telling them about for three and a half years is going to come to pass. The Bible says in Luke chapter, is everybody still with me? Say amen. The Bible records these words in Luke chapter 9 and verse 51. When the days were approaching for his ascension, he was determined to go to Jerusalem. I like that word, determined. It's an interesting word. It means if you're determined about something, it means several things. It means that you have a decision that is fixed, a fixed decision. It can mean, the NIV says that Jesus was resolute in his decision to go to Jerusalem. The ESV, English Standard Version, said it this way, that Jesus set his face on going to Jerusalem. He was determined to go to Jerusalem. The Bible, you know this verse. It's in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2, and I'll quote this verse. Listen to this verse of Scripture. The writer of Hebrews says, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and the perfecter or finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne, or the throne of God. He was determined to go to Jerusalem. Now, in that verse of Scripture, two things come into play. Number one, is what we do, and number two is what Jesus did. It says fixing our eyes on Jesus. How many of you understand that's what we're supposed to be doing? Amen? We are to fix our eyes on Jesus. Why? Because he's the author and the finisher of our faith. But not only are we to do that, we are to do it because the Bible says about Christ, it was the joy that was set before him that he endured the cross. Now, Jesus knew in his high priestly prayer, and we'll refer to that in just a moment in John 17, he knew what was coming in his life. God the Father had revealed to him what he was going to do in his life. His mission on earth was not to live this grand and glorious life. His mission here on earth was to die on the cross for the sin of all mankind. One commentator said it this way: when Jesus made his way to Jerusalem, he went through four certain areas. One, he went through Gethsemane. Amen? He went through Gethsemane. We call it the Garden of Gethsemane. And I've mentioned this to you before, that there in the Garden of Gethsemane, even though multiple thousands of years ago, there are at least, get this, church, there are at least seven olive trees, the perfect number seven. There are at least seven olive trees that they can identify were there at the time of Jesus praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. God doesn't do things out of order. He does everything in complete order. Would you say amen to that? But in the Garden of Gethsemane, the Bible says that Jesus prayed not once, not twice, but three times. Father, if it be thy will to let this cup pass from me. And the Bible says that as he was sweating, his sweat became as if they were drops of blood. Jesus was there. The Catholic Church has erected a Catholic church. It's called the Church of Agony, right there next to the Garden of Gethsemane. And there it is represented, the agony that our Savior Jesus had. His journey to Jerusalem went through Gethsemane. His journey to Jerusalem went through Golgotha. It's an interesting word. The word means this. In some translations, it says Golgotha, and then it will give an explanation, the place of the skull. Now, where that was just outside the city proper of Jerusalem. Now, we sing this song. We sing on a hill called Mount Calvary, don't we? It really was not a hill. It was an area outside. As a matter of fact, it was considered, the place of the skull was considered a place of a burning fire, or a dung hill, or a waste place. It was just outside. It wasn't the only place that people were crucified, or Jesus wasn't the only one that was crucified. It was a horrible place. He went through Gethsemane. He went through Golgotha. He went through the grave. The Bible says that he was buried in a borrowed tomb, Joseph of Arimathea. He was borrowed in a borrowed tomb, a borrowed grave, and then he went through a guarded tomb. You might remember the conversation. They came and they were sort of thinking among themselves. They were thinking, oh, wait a minute, you know, this guy said he's going to raise. He raised after 3 days, and Jesus had already said earlier, he said, if you tear this temple down, I will raise it up again in 3 days, and they didn't know what he was talking about. They were thinking he was talking about the physical temple that took 46 years to build, but he was talking about his own body, and therefore they couldn't allow that to happen. So what did they do? They put several guards upon the tomb of the Lord Jesus Christ because they were fearful that someone's going to come and steal his body. There's the pathway to the cross. Secondly, I want you to notice in this verse, there is the prophecy of the cross. Look in verse 17 as well. It said, as he was about to go up to Jerusalem, that's the pathway, he took his 12 disciples aside themselves, and on the way he said to them, behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be. He took his disciples aside, and he began to teach them about the prophecy of the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what is prophecy? Prophecy is a word that carries this different definition. Things yet to come. All right? So things yet to come. You have the Old Testament, which is the prophetic word of God that is written in a format that gives us an idea of what's going to happen in the future. You have the New Testament that looks back on the Old Testament and brings to fulfillment everything that was taught about in the Old Testament. You have the book of Revelation, the last book in the Bible, in the New Testament, that also is a prophetic book that tells us about some things that are yet to come. Now, there is one event that is yet to come that I believe is prophetic in Scripture, And I believe that is what we understand is the rapture of the church. I believe that is something that is yet to come. Now, some believe in the rapture, some do not believe in the rapture, and I'm not here to split hairs on that, but I want to tell you, dear friends, that some people say, well, what's the sign? What's the next sign before the rapture of the church, the catching up of the church that Paul talks about in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4? What's the sign? Is there going to be a handwriting on the wall? Is there going to be another earthquake? Is there going to be another catastrophe that's going to be the thing that precedes the rapture of the church? What's the sign for the rapture of the church? You all know the answer. There will be no sign. There will be no sign for the rapture. The only thing that has to happen is God the Father say to his Son, Son, it's time to go get my children. And then the Bible says, then we'll be caught up in the clouds with the Lord and with those, and we'll meet the Lord in the clouds in the air. So some people are like, well, I've got plenty of time. Oh, no, you don't. Jesus says about this prophecy over and over again in the text as he talks about the prophecy of the cross. You might remember that many times he would use this phrase, my time has not yet come. He used that phrase a number of times. I'll just identify two or three. John chapter 2 and verse 4 at the wedding ceremony, the first miracle that he performed, his mother said, do something about what's taking place here. And Jesus responds to his mom, my time has not yet come. In John 7 and verse 6 and verse 8 and verse 3, they were trying to seize Jesus Christ. They were trying to remove him out of the temple proper. And the Bible says that Jesus said, my time has not yet come. In John chapter 8 and verse 20, they were trying to arrest Jesus Christ. And he said, they can't arrest me because my time has not yet come. But then, in John chapter 17 and verse 1, what we call the high priestly prayer of the Lord Jesus Christ. Many of you would say that, the Lord's Prayer in Matthew chapter 4 and Luke chapter 11. You would say that's the Lord's Prayer. That's really not the Lord's Prayer. That's the model prayer. The Lord's Prayer is really in John chapter 17. And here's how it starts out. In his priestly prayer, Jesus said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son might glorify you. Now, how was Jesus going to glorify the Father? Can I give you a little insight? Through the death on the cross. That's how he was going to bring glory to the Father. Now, notice what he says here in this passage of Scripture in verse 17. Is everybody still there? He took the 12 disciples aside. So that tells me something here in that passage. If he takes the 12 disciples aside, first of all, that tells me that these guys were selected men. God selected them. Jesus selected them. Luke chapter 6 tells us that he selected them. It was at this time that he went off to the mountain to pray. He spent the whole night in prayer to God. And when he came, he called his disciples to him, and he chose 12 of them. Sounds like a selection to me, whom he also named as apostles. So they were selected men, but notice also in verse 17, you got to love this, they not only were selected men, they were a secluded group of people. He takes them aside by themselves. Verse 17. Matthew 26 and verse 36 gives us an idea about seclusion. They came with him to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit while I go over here and pray. Matthew 16, verse 22, when the apostle Peter, Jesus said, I'm going to go to the cross, and I'm going to be betrayed, I'm going to be mocked, I'm going to be ridiculed, and then I'm going to be raised again on the third day. The apostle Peter takes Jesus aside and rebukes him, saying, Lord, God forbid it. This shall never happen to you. The disciples still did not understand his message. I want you to jot down a couple passages for you to look at maybe one day this week. As we talk about the prophecy of the cross, there's two passages that are going to identify the prophecy of the cross probably more than any other, especially in the Old Testament. One is Psalm 22, and of course the other one is Isaiah 53. In Psalm 22, there are many references to the Lord Jesus Christ, and then also in Isaiah chapter 53, that is the suffering servant passage of Scripture. I don't have time to go through all those verses of Scripture, but I will read a couple of those. Listen to what he says in Psalm 22 and verse 1. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Have you heard that before? That's a prophetic word of God. And then he says it this way. He said, I'm poured out like water. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. For dogs have surrounded me, a band of evildoers. I count all my bones. They look, they stare at me. They divide my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Of course, you remember the verses in Isaiah 53 where the writer would record these words. He's despised and forsaken, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and like one from whom men hide their face, he was despised. We did not esteem him. Excuse me. Surely our griefs he himself bore, and our sorrows he carried, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, afflicted. He was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Chastising for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed. I love this verse. And all of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us have turned to his own way, but the Lord caused the iniquity of us all to fall on him. Do you understand what Jesus did for you, church? Do you understand that while Paul said it this way in Romans chapter 5 and verse 8? He says, for God commended his love toward us, that while we were yet a sinner, Christ died for us. That'll be a hearty amen right there. While I was yet a sinner, Christ died for me. While you were living in sin, while you were walking in sin, while you were out there doing your own thing, living your own life, thinking that you had the world by the horns, thinking that you had everything under the control of your own life, the Bible says all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And the Bible said, for the wages of that sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus, Lord, our Lord, only through Jesus Christ. And then Paul again reasserts, for God commended, he trans over that, he said he commended his love toward us that while we were yet a sinner, Christ died for us. I don't have a verse for this. It's just my conviction. I believe that if I was the only person born on the face of the earth, if you were the only person born on the face of the earth, guess what? You were still born in sin. You needed a Savior. And God the Father still sent his son Jesus to die for you. Amen? And for that, my dear friends, you ought to be thankful for. This is what Jesus was doing when he pulled the disciples aside and began to explain to them what was about to happen. He said, we're going to Jerusalem, and everything that was written by the prophets about the Son of Man are going to be accomplished. So there's a pathway to the cross. Second, the prophecy of the cross. Third, I want you to notice the punishment that comes by the cross. Look at verse 18 and 19 again in Matthew chapter 20. Notice the punishment. Behold, we're going up to Jerusalem. The Son of Man will be delivered to the chief priests and the scribes, and they will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles and to mock and to scourge and to crucify him. And on the third day, he will be what, church? Raised up. Now, there's some things that you need to understand here in this passage of Scripture, and I jotted these down in my notes in verse 18 and 19. And notice what happens here. First of all, he's going to be delivered. But who is he going to be delivered to? If you see this in verse number 18, it's interesting. And here's what I put down in my notes. I know your Bible will say the chief priests and the scribes, but I want you to jot this down maybe in a bulletin or whatever it might be. Religious folk. He was delivered to the religious people. He was delivered to the religious people of that day. We would call them pious people. You ever heard that word? Yes. Heard a preacher say one time? Said, I just can't stand pious people. They pious me off. I was repeating what someone else said there. These are the religious people. These are the people who think they've got it all together, the ones who are calling all the shots in the local church. They're the ones, if it's not their way, it's nobody's way. These are the ones that you don't get anything in a church unless it goes through person A or B, whatever it might be. They delivered Jesus over to the people who are supposed to be godly, but they were really ungodly. The second thing I'll call your attention to is in verse 18, and that is what happened to him. He was condemned to die. He was condemned to death. How many of you remember when Jesus was standing there next to Pilate, and next to Jesus and Pilate was also a young man, another man named Barabbas, a known criminal of the day. And Pilate says to the crowd, he yells back and he says, and who do you want me to release to you? Meaning, who do you want me to free? Here's Jesus, hadn't done anything wrong, and here's Barabbas, that's a known criminal, and Pilate says, who do you want me to release to set free? And the crowd yelled out, Barabbas, set him free. And that's exactly what he did. Jesus was delivered to the religious people. He was condemned to die. And then notice what happens in verse number 19. He was handed over to the Gentiles. The word there for Gentiles could also mean the Romans. The Jews couldn't do the crucifixion, so they had to hand it over to people who knew about crucifixion, and that was the Romans. And what were the Romans going to do to him? It said that they were going to mock him and scourge him and crucify him. What do those words mean? You need to understand what those words mean. What does it mean to mock someone? It means to ridicule them. It means to verbally assault them. You might remember what happened as Jesus was there on the cross. They said to Jesus, said, hey, so-called Jesus, you saved others. Why don't you save yourself? That's mocking him. They scourged him. The word scourge means to cause pain. It's talking about physical pain. Well, how do you cause physical pain? You whip someone, you flog someone. It actually means his body was ravaged because of what he went through. I'm not going to show any videos or pictures or anything like that. I don't know. But all I do know is whatever he went through, he went through. Listen, not because of his sin, but because of my sin. The sinless Savior was scourged and mocked, and then they crucified him. Now, what does that word mean? It means this. They sought to destroy him. They thought that when Jesus was crucified and died on the cross, they figured that maybe they had this guy all done with. That's why they set a guard over his tomb. They didn't want anyone to steal his body and give the understanding and the indication that maybe he did raise from the grave. They didn't want that to spread through the town. But you also have to remember what happened when Pilate released Barabbas back to them. What do you want us to do? Who do you want me to release, Barabbas or Jesus? Barabbas! Let's free him. Now there's Jesus standing there. Well, what do you want me to do with this fellow Jesus? The crowd yelled out, what, church? Crucify him! Crucify him! Thousands and thousands of people. Sounds like our world today. Instead of punishing the criminal, we want to punish the ones who are doing what is right. We live in a messed up world, church, don't we? But notice what it says here in verse 19, and I need to move on. Crucify him. Now, does anyone notice today that I'm wearing some jewelry? I don't normally do that. I usually wear a watch and a ring. That's usually what I'll wear jewelry related. I don't have French cuffs on today, so I don't have my cufflinks on. I'll do that 90% of the time, whatever it might be. I'm wearing a necklace today. It's in the shape of a cross. Someone made this for me. I thought it was made out of nails. Wade, what'd you say they were? Horseshoe nails. I thought a nail's a nail. And then wrapped. Pretty cool. A friend of mine made this for me several years ago. And many of you might wear a necklace in the shape of a cross as well. I'm not discounting that one bit. It's a nice piece of jewelry, but I think what we've done is we've misunderstood the symbolism of the cross. Because Jesus went to the cross, which was a cruel, rugged way to die. It is not a symbol of jewelry, it is a symbol of pain. And what we have to understand about crucifixion, first of all, is it was perfected by the Romans. That's why in verse number 19 it says we're going to hand him over to the Gentiles. We're going to hand him over to the Romans. Why? Is this going to be the first person they crucified? No. This was a daily thing for the Romans. They crucified thousands of people every year. They had it down to a science. They knew exactly what it was. It was a daily practice for them to crucify criminals. Not only did they perfect it, crucifixion was a humiliation to the one that was being crucified. The Bible tells us they would be stripped and naked and paraded before the people as they made their way to the place of the crucifixion. Before the Romans perfected crucifixion, one of the ways that people would crucify or put people to death is they would impale them with a post. The Romans took it and made it a crucifixion on the cross. They would have a post that was there, and they would encourage or cause that person to carry the beam of that cross, and on their way to the place of crucifixion, they would be mocked, They would be ridiculed. They would be spat upon. They would be jeered at. And that's exactly what happened to our Savior Jesus. So the Romans perfected crucifixion. The Romans made sure that that person was humiliated. But also crucifixion was brutal. The brutality of the experience. The torture of crucifixion, being nailed to the cross. I'm not going to get into an argument. Was the nails put through the hands or was the nails put through the wrist? I have my own understanding of that. But you have to understand the brutality of being nailed to a cross. And then the public display for the people. Maybe you didn't understand this because you might remember that they came when Jesus was hanging on the cross. They came, and one of the things that they tried to do to speed up the process of dying is that they would break the person's legs. But they didn't have to do that for Jesus because he was already dead. Amen? Understand that? But what you have to understand is that person would be on that cross, and they would fight for their life to stay alive as long as they possibly could. They would be hanging there by the cross, but their feet would be on this little pedestal, and what they would do is that person would ultimately die because of suffocation, because they couldn't hold the weight of their body up, and they would try to push the weight of their body up, and these people, some people would last 2, 3, 4 days. And the people in the crowd in the town would walk by these individuals, these people being hanged on a cross for 2, 3, 4 days, ridicule, spit, mock, continue, until that person would ultimately die. So when we talk about the cross, what is it? Well, let me give you these three things. It won't be on the screen. Well, the cross, first of all, I think is a symbol of your Christian faith. And by the way, let me tell you this, that some people wear a cross that has Jesus on the cross. Some of the Catholic religion, others. That is not what we want to portray, because Jesus is no longer on the cross. Amen? He was on the cross. He was buried in a tomb. He was raised the third day, and he's no longer on the cross. But it's a symbol of your Christian faith. If someone sees a cross around your neck, they're going to assume, oh, that person must be a Christian. Number two, it is a symbol of your commitment to Christ. It ought to be a symbol of your commitment to Christ. Jesus said it this way in Luke chapter 9 and verse 23, one of my top 10 verses of Scripture. He said, if any man wishes and desires to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, how often? Daily, and follow me. So if you wear a cross around your neck, it's a symbol of your Christian faith. It's a symbol of your commitment to Christ. But it's also, third, a symbol of your crucified life. Paul said it this way in Galatians 2:20. We love that verse. Paul said, I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself up for me. So let me just touch on this for just a moment and we'll get you out of here today. The cross is a symbol of your Christian faith. I'm a follower of Jesus. The cross is a symbol of your commitment to Christ. It's a reminder of whose you are, that you are now part of the Lord Jesus Christ, but it's also a symbol of your crucified life. We talked about this in our Sunday school class this morning, and that was this. Persecution as a Christian. If the church is not under persecution, then you're becoming too much like the world. Amen? And if you want to become so much like the world, then take the name church off the church. If you want to be a social club, be a social club. If you want to be a bank, be a bank. But if you want to be a church of the Lord Jesus Christ and the living God, you've got to understand there's going to be persecution that's going to come from that. And when Jesus said, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, the cross is a picture of martyrdom. It is a picture of following the Lord Jesus Christ. I like what one of the disciples said when Jesus said, we're going to Jerusalem. And they had this conversation, and they knew what was going to happen, even though he'd been telling them. They knew that Jesus was going to Jerusalem. He's going to ultimately and eventually die. And one of the disciples said, well, we might as well go there too. Because they assumed that they were going to die for Christ as well. So there's the pathway of the cross, the prophecy of the cross, the punishment of the cross. Let's end and look at verse number 19, and there's the plan of the cross. The plan of the cross. Look again at verse 19. They will hand him over to the Gentiles to mock and scourge and crucify him. And on the third day, he will be raised up. It didn't say that he might be raised up. It said he would be raised up. That's a promise from God. Amen? That is a promise from God. Matter of fact, let me just give a few verses of scripture, and I'll end with this. And you could jot these references down. Acts chapter 10, verse 39 through 41. Listen to what the word says. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him up on the third day and made him to appear not to all people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3 and 4, the gospel in a nutshell. Paul said it this way, I deliver to you as of first importance what I also received. Here's the gospel, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised again on the third day according to the scriptures. You hear that? Paul said it this way, Christ died, Christ was buried, and Christ was raised again. That's the gospel. Christ died, Christ was buried, and Christ was raised again. 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 54 through 57. I use this often at the graveside services for a believer in Christ. Paul said it this way, when this corruptible, this sin, has put on incorruption, this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is the victory? The sting of death is sin, but the strength of sin is the law. And then Paul ends by saying this, but thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to what he says again. Go home and read this passage of scripture in 1 Corinthians 15 again. It's a long chapter. Death is swallowed up in victory. Death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Listen, my dear friends. Paul said, absent from the body, present with the Lord. Amen? We are not created to live here for eternity. We're created to live with Jesus for all eternity. And this is not our final resting place. And then one more verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 22. Paul said this, for as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. I love that verse of scripture. So in Adam all die, but in Christ all are made alive. Now, I don't know where you are in your relationship with God today. I don't know if you know him as your personal Savior and Lord or not. It's for me to understand and to know, but that's for me to convey to you that you need to know that you have Jesus Christ in your heart as your personal Savior and Lord. Because if you don't have Jesus in your heart as your personal Savior and Lord, the Bible says that one day you too will die and you will not go to heaven. You will go to a place that God has created, listen, for Satan and his angels, but for those who rejected Jesus Christ as personal Savior and Lord, we call that place hell. But for those of you who have placed your faith and trust in Jesus Christ as personal Savior and Lord, he's written your name down in the Lamb's Book of Life. And Jesus said in John chapter 10 that it can never be blotted out. You ought to say amen to that. Man, you're really excited, church. I mean, you think about that. You go and you place a reservation down. And Teresa and I, the Southern Baptist Convention is going to be in Indianapolis this year. And I'm born and raised from Indianapolis. I grew up on the west side of Indianapolis. I know where everything is pretty much around the whole town. I did route work for 11 years. I know all the alleys. I know the back ways around the place. I know all of that. But there's one restaurant in Indianapolis that I've never had a chance to eat at, and it's called St. Elmo's Steakhouse. It's one of the top 10 steakhouses in the entire country. Now, I used to fill vending machines, and now I've been to St. Elmo's Steakhouse because I used to fill the cigarette machine that was there in the foyer. That's part of what my job was, fill the candy machines, pop machines, cigarette machines, that's what I did. But I've never eaten there. Now, I just can't walk into St. Elmo's Steakhouse and say, hey, King David and Sister Teresa's here. Find us a table. I can't say that. I've got to call ahead, and I've got to make a reservation for a certain time. And when I walk in, well, that's my plan. I've got to save my pennies. So when I walk in, I want to be able to say, okay, what's your name? My name's David Purichia. I have a reservation for 7 o'clock. There it is. Your name's right down there. Come right on in. We'll seat you at the table. You can't show up to the kingdom of God and say, Jesus, I'm a good dude. You know, I went to church every time the doors were open. My mom and dad were leaders in the church. That didn't get you in. That didn't get you in. Being a good person doesn't get you in. Wearing nice clothes doesn't get you in. There's only one way that gets you in, and that's confessing your sin, repenting of that sin, and believing that Jesus Christ died for your sin. That's the only way you get in. And aren't you glad that Jesus went to a place called Calvary and took that journey for us that we don't have to take? Amen? Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior and Lord, I would love to introduce you to Him today. There's men and women here in our fellowship that could sit down with you and share with you and pray with you and help you to where you can come to a saving faith of the Lord Jesus Christ as well. They would be glad to sit down and to talk with you. If you need to stay afterwards, heads are bowed and eyes are closed, and you need to come to faith in Christ, whatever that need is, if it's salvation, if it's recommitment today, our worship team is going to sing an old hymn of invitation today. And if the Spirit of God is speaking to your heart, this altar is open. There's a kneeling bench here that you can sit, you can kneel to. There's some seats up here you can come and you can sit. And if you just want to pull somebody aside and say, hey, would you pray with me? They'd be glad to do that. Lord God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for the journey you took to Calvary. We'll never understand. We can't get a glimpse of the true picture of what happened. We do have some records of it in your word. But the greatness of my sin and the greatness of your grace, I can't make those two things come together. But you did. Through your grace and your mercy, you didn't give me or these folks here today what we deserved. You gave us grace and mercy and love. And I'm thankful for that. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord, to do what you want us to do. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. There's room at the cross for you. As we stand this morning, you need to come. I want to invite you to come.
The cross upon which Jesus died is a shelter in which we can hide, and its grace so free is sufficient for me, and deep is its fountain as wide as the sea. There's room and
You be seated for just a moment. Skylar, if you could make your way up here, please.